Welcome to the next session, the radiology in the diagnosis of tuberculosis. Today the session in the radiology of tuberculosis, we are going to discuss about the radiological features of a extrapulmonary TB. Extrapulmonary TB refers to TB involving other than lung parenchyma. So, extrapulmonary means always it is a spread from hemorrhogenous or there may be a direct extension from a primary TB. So, extrapulmonary TB can present either as a primary TB or it can present both primary pulmonary TB and extrapulmonary. So, it accounts for 15% to 20% of the tuberculosis cases. Diagnosis of extrapulmonary is often very difficult, but high index of clinical suspicion with typical or atypical radiological features, we can able to diagnose extrapulmonary TB. The first commonest extrapulmonary TB is a peripheral lymphadenopathy. It is the most commonest form. It accounts for 20% to 40% of the extrapulmonary TB. It is known as a King's evil. This is more common in children and female and also seen in a HIV zero positive patients in a low CD4 count. So, here there is a soft tissue swelling on either side of the neck. X-ray can identify cervical lymphadenopathy. However, ultrasonogram can able to make size of the node, multiple nodes, number of nodes, either matting or presence of any caseous necrosis, and also helps to make a diagnostic purpose. It is a chest wall or cold abscess. It is characterized by destruction of the bone with formation of the subcutaneous mass. It is infection of the rib by tuberculous MTB complex. So, it is either occur by direct extension from a pleuroparenchymal disease or hematogenous spread from a distant site. So, radiologically it present as a peripheral mass in a costal area having a D shape opacity or a incomplete border stain. So, whenever you have this type of opacity, either it could be a loculated effusion or a chest wall abscess. This is X-ray showing pericardial effusion. Pericardial effusion estimated to occur 1% to 8% of patients with the pulmonary TB. There has TB as the major cause for all pericardial effusion majority, and it accounts for 60% to 80% of the cases. And this pericardial effusion is commonly seen in 3rd to 5th decade of life. Pericardium is involved directly from the pulmonary tuberculosis or from extension from the node. Radiologically, pericardial effusion appear as a globular enlargement of the heart giving the size of the water bottle configuration. So, with ATT with steroid, it resolve completely. There are 4 stages of pericardial involvement. Pericardial effusion is the 3rd stage. So, 20% of the cases they go for a constrictive pericarditis. This is tuberculosis involving the spine. Skeletal involvement occur in 1% to 3% of the patients with tuberculosis. spine is the most commonest site of osseous involvement. It accounts for 50% of the all skeletal tuberculosis. So, most common site is L1. Sometimes two contiguous bones are involved. The disease process often begins in the anterior part of the vertebral body and adjacent end plate, leading to the collapse of the vertebral body, resulting in tuberculous kyphosis. Radiologically, TB spine has been diagnosed with the loss of distinction of the end plate, and there is a destruction of the vertebral body, and there is a anterior, it is more seen in the anterior, and there is a loss of a disc height. So, this is a lateral X-ray showing reduced height of the vertebral body. MRI is more sensitive and specific for diagnosis of spinal TB. It provides early detection. So, this is a MRI showing T2 weighted image. It shows there is a epidural abscess. So, there is a destruction of the vertebra and disc size is also reduced. Here is X-ray showing destruction as a coronal axial view showing destruction of the vertebrae. This is the paraspinal abscess due to TB spondylitis. So, it is seen as a fusiform swelling on either side of the spine. So, presence of calcification is more in favor of a paraspinal abscess due to tuberculosis. This is a X-ray showing TB-Dactylitis. What is TB-Dactylitis? TB-Dactylitis is tuberculosis involvement of the short tubular bone of hand and feet. It is more common in children. So, there is a fusiform soft tissue swelling and periosteitis. These are the two or more important findings as the underlying bone is destroyed. A cyst like cavity is formed and the remaining bone appear to be ballooned out. This appearance is termed as spina ventosa. So, this is a globular soft tissue swelling with destruction of the periosteum. Next, tuberculosis involvement of the brain. So, central nervous system tuberculosis may take variety of form. They have meningitis, tuberculoma, abscess and miliary TB. This is a tuberculoma of the brain. So, it is usually due to hematogenous spread from the systemic disease or extension of CSF fluid into the adjacent parenchyma. Tuberculoma may be single or multiple. So, usually seen in the frontal lobe or parietal lobe. So, MRI is the very sensitive test for diagnosing tuberculoma. It shows a solid enhancing lesion. It is called the central hyperintensity and peripheral hyperintensity. It is a hallmark of a tuberculoma of the brain. So, here there is a peripheral hyposensitivity and a central hypointensity. This is a basal meningitis. It is believed to be caused by rupture of the its focus into cerebrospinal fluid. So, MRI shows there is a abnormal meningeal enhancement that is typically involve basic cisterns. The enhancements correspond to gelatinous exudate. So, here there is a abnormal enhancement in the basal cistern. This is a cerebral abscess. So, cerebral abscess is a rare form of a CNS tuberculosis. So, usually it involves a frontal lobe. So, it consists of a central tuberculoma surrounded by a abundant vasogenic edema. This is a classical of abundant vasogenic edema. It is usually seen in a immunocompromised individual and children. This is a central mass surrounded by a vasovagal edema. Next is a hydrocephalus. It is the most common complication of tuberculosis meningitis, occurring in 85% of the children with the disease. It is more severe in children than adult. There are two types of hydrocephalus. One is a communicating hydrocephalus or obstructive hydrocephalus. So, here this MRI showing the ventriculomegaly and a periventricular interstitial edema. Let us coming to the radiological features of a TB abdomen. The commonest involvement is a ileocecal junction. It is seen in 80% to 90% of patients with the abdominal tuberculosis. The reason being, there is an abundant lymphoid tissue in the ileocecal junction. So, there is a multiple calcifications of the mesenteric nodes. So, here the barium meal study showing thickening of the ileum, dilatation and clumping of a bowel loop. It is a feature of a TB abdomen. So, this x-ray of plain x-ray abdomen showing multiple fluid levels. It is a dilated bowel with the multiple fluid levels. So, this is a CT abdomen showing thickening of the cecum and a terminal ileum. Coming to genitourinary tuberculosis. So, genitourinary tuberculosis is uncommon in children because it presents 5 to 25 years after the primary infection. It comprises 3 to 5% of all TB cases. So, after lymphadenopathy, it is the most common form of extrapulmonary TB. The earliest abnormality is a moth-eaten appearance of the calyces. So, this is the intravenous pyelogram showing irregular moth-eaten calyces. This is the earliest finding in a TB kidney. It is due to necrosis and erosion of the calyces. So, it is also a moth-eaten calyces. So, here TB involving the kidney, the plain abdomen of radiograph showing reniform shaped calcification with lobulation representing calcified caseous tissue. It is known as a cement kidney. It is usually sequelae of a TB kidney. Next is tuberculosis involving the bladder. So, tuberculosis usually involves the wall of the bladder. It causes calcification in wall and also there is a contraction of the bladder wall. The capacity of the bladder is reduced. So, we call it as a thimble bladder. This is the pathognomic of a TB bladder in a tuberculosis. Coming to what are the limitations of the chest x-ray? chest X-ray is a two-dimensional representation of a three-dimensional structure. There is an intra-reader and inter-reader variability. So, there may be due to over-reading or under-reading, but no abnormalities are definite of TB because the opacity may be shared by even other infectious process also. So, it has a low sensitivity. X-ray chest is not good in early stages of miliary TB because the nodules, miliary nodules are missed in a X-ray. So, in there is a 15% of the miliary TB X-ray may be normal, and differentiating active from healed TB based on X-ray is very difficult, and there is lack of universally accepted reporting system, and there is a exposure of the patients to ionizing radiation, and reading of the there is a requirement of special equipment for taking X-ray, and trained personnel are required to operate and interpret the results. So, the X-ray, there is a limited access in the rural area. So, access is limited to district or regional levels. The key message is chest radiograph is a sensitive and complementary tool in diagnosis of pulmonary TB. Imaging is useful in the diagnostic workup of extrapulmonary TB. Thank you. With this, we end the session on radiology in the diagnosis of TB. Thank you.